Save our schools! Save our schools! Save our schools! Opt out, Philly!
Children by race and gender? How are they coming prepared to teach your children? These are valid questions to ask, and you want answers to those questions. When it comes to the history of the people that you are teaching, this is something you've got to take coursework with, for, whatever it is, you've got to do it. You should do it. Parents need to do it too. Thank you.
Thank you.
$2 million worth of a benefit in somebody else's pocket. So none of this money comes back into the public school system. If anything, I want you to think about, if you've ever visited a jail, that's what you can imagine the transition is for our schools, our public schools. They have to cover up every and anything that has any spelling words on it, any letters, any numbers, anything that could possibly be construed as something that may give a child an advantage during this test. So the schools literally go from being this inviting, invigorating, purposeful educational atmosphere to a prison setting. Everything's covered. And, you know, I'll give you another example. If your cell phone falls out during the course of the, you know, school day, of course the teacher may or may not tell you, warning, put that cell phone away. If I see it again, I'll take that. During the PSSAs, if the cell phone falls out, the cell phone is then confiscated and shipped out to Harrisburg, and then they, for investigation, to see what documents, you know, it's a whole conspiracy behind the scenes.
For our opt-out organizing meeting in Strawberry Mansion, today was a great success. I'm very proud of all the work that we did today and raising our voice about opting out. And Carly King, she's here from Northeast Treatment Center. They sponsored this event. Although they didn't want to say sponsors, they said partners. Yeah, so they are community partners, and all this good food that you all are eating is because of NET, Northeast Treatment Center. So she's just going to step up and talk a little bit about the resources that they offer, and here's Carly.
Absolutely. So we're here today for a very important educational issue. I'm not going to take up a lot of your time, but I just wanted to say welcome and thank you all on behalf of NET Community Care. We are a nonprofit agency, and we're actually located in LP Hill School next to Strawberry Mansion High. Everyone building for community services, and so we're the first nonprofit agency to move into that empty building. What we do, people know Northeast Treatment Centers is a drug and alcohol or behavioral health program. We do that, and that's in other parts of the city, but that's not why we're here in Strawberry Mansion. What we are is a child welfare agency. We focus on child safety, family well-being, parent engagement, and overall community development. There's a portion of my agency that works with DHS. So in efforts of full disclosure, yes, we do work with DHS, and we're working with families that might have some struggles relating to child abuse or neglect. But what I'm here representing today is the portion of our agency that helps communities to strengthen your family before you have to have that DHS involvement. I can guarantee you, we don't want to take people's kids. We don't want your children. But what we want to do is we want to see families strengthened to their fullest potential so that we don't have families interfacing with that system at a crisis moment. So we have a table over here, and I just encourage when we finish with the forum and the panel, if you'll stop by or come meet me, talk to me. We do parenting classes, not your traditional parenting class where someone's teaching you how to change a diaper or telling you're a bad parent for how you discipline. We don't do any of that. We have a judgment-free zone that we call a parent cafe, and we love to invite parents out when we offer childcare, so you have no excuses for not having a babysitter.
We have a full meal often catered by Taste of Heaven, Miss Tracy's Taste of Heaven that catered today, or some of our community residents, Miss Sherry Brown, an elegant experience. So we offer a full hot meal at every parent cafe. We offer childcare. We offer tokens. We give prizes, raffles, certificates for your participation. But the best part is that it's a judgment-free zone for parents to debrief and talk to other parents. What do you do when your three-year-old's tantruming in the store and it's really embarrassing? What do you do when your teenager starts giving you their rear end instead of that lovely little sweet child that you once knew? All those kind of things, and you just share and build with other parents. It's part of building a community of social connections and support to help you. When that crisis moment comes, you have other supports to kind of keep you out of trouble with your family. We also do other things in the community, like focus on faith-based communities, the criminal justice system, all these other entities, poverty, homelessness, mental health, all these other things that affect families and your well-being. How can we help you as a family? How can we help this community so that we can address those needs before they become a larger issue? So we're here. We're in the LP Hill School. We're also always looking for foster parents. I have another shirt that I wish I wore today that says, keep calm and foster a teen. Let me tell you that we have 700 children just in the 22nd Police District, just in North Central Philadelphia. That includes Strawberry Mansion, Brewery Town, Francisville, Yorktown, the whole area around Temple. 700 children that are now in DHS care. A good percentage of those are teenagers. If teenagers cannot find homes in their own neighborhood, they will be removed from Strawberry Mansion High and sent to a group home, an institutional facility in another county, in upstate PA, in Pittsburgh, and somewhere else. Our children do not deserve to be raised in facilities. We don't believe that children deserve to be raised in facilities.
That's right.
We want
That's
homes
right.
for our kids. So even when families are struggling and a child might have to come into foster care, believe me, I'm trying to prevent it, but it happens sometimes, and we need the community to step up for our own children. We can't rely on institutions and other people in other counties and other places to care for the children from our community. So we're reaching out and saying, yes, we want to help families, but we need community to help us to help families too. So if you're interested in learning more about how you might be able to mentor, become a foster parent, help a neighbor that you know is struggling with their children, or any way that you can help and mentor and deal with trauma and mental health and family stability, come talk to us. I would love to talk to you and think of some creative ways that we can help in the community. Okay?
Like, Amy is the best. I could cry right now, and I'm trying to hold my tears in because this is a movement about empowering our parents to understand what's going on with public education. And I have an awesome group of people behind me who have been doing the work. And it's just awesome to have their support to be here and do the work that they do. So I just want to thank all of y'all for everything. Because without y'all, we don't have a movement. I mean, we need each other. We need the parents and we need the educators to come together. So I just want to say thank you. Thank you so much. And then I want to introduce our superhero. Because this man is awesome. He's walking from Connecticut to Washington, D.C. to also raise awareness about teaching to the test, about the dismantling of public education. Jesse Turner.
I can do that. Okay, my mission is to connect the dots across the country. What if they created a system that was meant to make you fail? What if they created a system where failure became their profits? This is the system that I'm seeing. So I'll tell you right now, 2015, the Quality Counts Education Report from Ed Week says 49 states spend more money on their wealthy schools than their poor schools. What's that called? That's immoral. That's injustice. And we're not doing anything about it. We're talking about test scores. So I see that component. Now I'll give you three little quick things on the data. I'm a professor of language, reading, and culture. I followed the data. I'm sort of a data junkie. And I have followed the data on this No Child Left Behind, Race to the Top, privatization, charterize the world. I have followed their data. And there are three studies. One is the Reading First study, which was George Bush. And they promised that every child would be a reader if they attended a Reader First school. And they spent $6 billion in 6 years. They created 5 gold Cadillac programs, and that's the experimental programs. And then they said, but we're going to show you how well this works, because we're going to have a control group, and that's the group you should feel sorry for. We don't want you to know, but we're not going to do anything different for you over there. And so at the end of 6 years, the data came back. President Bush didn't want to talk about it. Secretary Page didn't want to talk about it. Secretary Spellin didn't want to talk about it. But at the end of 6 years, every single experimental program showed a loss of comprehension. The only group that showed some growth, the ones we didn't care about, the control group. Barack Obama came in, Arne Duncan, a semi-pro basketball player with no experience in education, never been a teacher, never worked in a school building, never been a principal, never even been a security guard in the building, never even worked in the cafeteria, had no school-based experience. He came in and he said, you know, I can do the same thing, I could do better. They were off. They went from K to 3 they looked at, so what I'm going to do is go to grade 5. And he did, and so we had the supplemental reading program impact study. At the end of the year, what happens? You got it. Every experimental program they spent billions of dollars for that demanded that local poor schools follow showed a decline in comprehension. The control group, once again, showed growth. Now Duncan says, well, that's only one. Let's do it in the sixth grade. Same thing, same study all over, different grade. At the end of the year, same results. So what we have is all the kids in the experimental programs, the things that our federal government said would make our children smart, make them readers, do well, pass the very test they were talking about. At the end of that year, all of those students that got the treatment, they lost comprehension. The students that were in the control group and got no treatment, they're the only ones that showed some growth. If this were a medicine, and I was putting a medicine to test, that would mean everybody would have died in the group. So in 2010, when that data came in, I wrote to my president, I went to DC, I told the Secretary of Education, I said, here's the data. Everything you have proposed, everything that the past three secretaries of education have proposed, are failing. And so when we look at that billions of dollars, $1.2 trillion has been spent on No Child Left Behind, you see it in your school. You see it in that 1.23 million? We shouldn't be closing Strawberry Hill. We should expand it. We shouldn't be closing any public schools. We should be expanding. $1 trillion should have meant I should have hired more teachers. I could have sent every young person to college for free. And I could have said, all you need to do is come to our school for 10 hours a week and read to a child. Help a child do math. I could have did something innovative and creative. But what did they do? And this is what we need to understand. Have you ever known a standardized test that's really been good for people of color? I haven't known one. Have you ever known a standardized test that's been good for poor people? This is my area. I teach the assessment courses. I haven't known one. If you want to know, have you ever seen a standardized test that has helped elevate immigrant communities? I have not seen it. I have not noticed it. And what do we have? At the end, what we have is a focus on testing and one more little piece of data. I tell people, yeah, we had testing when we were in school. You're about as old as me. I'm 60. I took tests 3 times, once in elementary, once in middle school, once in high school. I tell parents this all the time. And each time they gave me those tests, no more than 2 days was lost. And my teachers even told me, they said, hey, look, kids, don't feel bad about this. This is a stupid test. Do what you can, get by, do the best you can, and it's over with. So at the end, by the time I left high school, I lost 6 days of instruction. I'm going to give you the last piece of data. In 2013, that's an important year, because that's the year where our high school students left high school knowing nothing but their experimental reforms. And that group on the SAT scores, They have not scored this low in 4 decades. And we need to be looking at their data. I'm tired of them telling, what's the test scores of your school? We're going to close your school. Watch this. How's that? You know, and I'm thinking, they're measuring us. Do we not remember this? It's like when you went to Ellis, when people went to Ellis Island, and they looked and they said, you're tilting a little. Maybe you're sick. Oh, you cough too much. You know, maybe you go back. It's the same thing that was on the auction block of slavery. They were looking at, they're talking about who's proficient, who's below proficiency, who's at proficiency. Is that the way we talk about our children?
Approach to education, where we're dumping the losers. It's always about make sure that there's a bunch of schools at the bottom and close those schools or turn them around or redesign them. And largely, that's determined by test scores. And these are very unfair tests. They're designed for children to fail. So I've just been out in the community over the past couple years with the folks behind me who are both community members, fellow parents, and educators to let parents know.
Yeah, you still got a
in
table
Pennsylvania,
here.
There are two high-stakes tests.
Okay.
One is the PSSAs, and that is for grades 3 to 8, and they're administered every year. And there are benchmark tests in between. The others are Keystones, which are new tests that are for high school students. And high school students must pass 3 exams or they will not get any diploma. So what matter what their grades were in high school, if they did well, if they don't pass all 3 high school these exit exams, they won't graduate. So I've been sharing with communities that for the PSSA test, the grades 3 through 8, in Pennsylvania we have a legal right to opt out. Now this legal right to opt out is on religious grounds, and there's a process where you simply review the test, you sign a confidentiality agreement saying you won't talk about it, and then you state, I have a religious objection and I'm opting my child out of these tests. And they can't refuse you and they can't ask you anything about your religion or anything about opting out or intimidate you in any way. And they have to make provisions for your child in the classroom during testing. And what Jesse was saying, weeks upon weeks upon weeks of class time are lost to testing and test prep. So we were organizing around opt-out this past spring. There's a number of folks behind me who can tell. In addition, there's a second way, and you can just simply refuse. So the school district at the sort of the end game last spring acknowledged that you can write a letter saying that your child is under direction to refuse the test, and you don't have to come in and do the review. And they code it as other. And in both cases, the students don't get a zero. It's not scored. As if they didn't take it, they have no score. The scores are not held against the schools or the teachers. So that's important information to have. The second piece are the Keystones, which are a little trickier. Starting with the class of 2017, currently, which are rising juniors, they have to pass to get a diploma. So opting out is not really the best.
My name is Antoine James. I go to Sammy Phelps High School. My experience doing the test, it was...
Can you hear me?
A little bit louder? It's good?
It's good.
Yeah. Cool. My experience doing the test, it was difficult because half of the stuff that was in the test we never learned it in school. So it was just like, they asked us like weird questions like, how long was the tree and what did you do like when they put the wire on the tree or something like that. But it was like nothing that had nothing with school. So it was like, it was just like a crazy experience. So it was just people, like when the time was like for the testing, people either left or people just didn't do it. And I mean, I knew a girl that cried over the test and actually called her mom after the test because she said she didn't know nothing on the test. So that's why it was like a bad experience.
Hi, my name is Tanya Ba, and I'm a parent of twins, a boy and a girl. Actually, one is special needs, both had IEPs, and both attend public schools. So basically what I want to share is that I'm not interested in health fairs or prison forums or anything else that an elected official might want to talk about until they're ready to talk about Keystone exams, PSSAs, or PASAs. And so I think what happens now is when they see me, they expect and they understand that we're going to talk about some real issues. It is very important that you exercise your right as a parent, as a teacher, as a community member, because what happens in the school to our students will affect your neighbor, will affect your block, will affect your community. The level of service that you're going to receive, whether you're going to the Rite Aid, the CVS, or you're going to the library, the hospital, everything will now be affected. The most important thing that you can do to upset me would be to stand in the way of a high school diploma. And so the mere fact that there was a really little lady at a home and school association meeting talking about opting out and the opportunity to actually not take a standardized test and to have your child's grades, your child's teacher recommendations, and the past experience that your child has had in the school should make a better difference, should make a difference, as opposed to a score on a standardized test.
Yes.
It got me excited. And once I got excited, I started connecting with the other parents. And Allison put together a sheet. She had a paper that basically spelled out what our rights were, and you were able to go submit this to the school with your child's name on it, and then agree to review the test, and then opt out. And then we had some concerns with regard to 440. And then another parent, Tamika, had another example of a letter that she wrote where she basically told them that she was opting her child out, she wasn't going to review the test, and that she was going to have her rights respected. I just copied her letter, and I copied it 531 times. And so Wagner Middle School, which has 6th, 7th, and 8th graders, I talked directly to the students, and I let them know what they were up against. I explained to them, because as far as I'm concerned, the parents are distracted. They're trying to decide between food and lights, coats, shoes. So I talked to the students, and I asked them, raise your hand if you're excited about taking the PSSAs. No hand went up. So let me tell you how you can get out of taking this test that will now determine whether or not you get to go to Central, Girls High, SLA, Carver. Instead of your report card, instead of what your teacher has to say, this test is going to talk for you. So let me tell you how you can get out of taking this test and to regain some control over what happens next for you. Take this sheet home and ask your mom to sign it, your mom or your dad. You fill out your name, bring it back to school, and basically you're not going to have to take the PSSAs. They did it. They took it home.
A lot of them.
A lot of them.
160.
Directly to the people that it's affecting, and that would be the kids. Now, of course, you know, it does take an adult to bring the subject up. Bring it up if you go to community meetings, if you go to block meetings, if you go to the neighborhood store. Start the conversation and continue the conversation. And every time somebody has a town hall meeting or a prison forum or a health fair, and they're an elected official, just like Jesse said, you don't listen to us, we take our votes away.
Right.
And it will make a statement. He knows what he's talking about. He's on the right path. And so I'm following that. I like the idea that I can threaten you with my vote.
Keep your data.
That's really all I have to say.
Hi, my name is Amy Root. I am an ESOL teacher in the School District of Philadelphia, but I did teach elementary school for 15 years. I taught at Alexander Wilson in Southwest Philly. It is closed. It was a wonderful little gem of a school, but they didn't like our test scores, so it's closed. And then they gave it away to one of the local universities out there in West Philly. I also taught at Anna B. Pratt, which is at 22nd and Susquehanna, and had a good time there. That school's closed. After they put in a very, very nice playground, the teachers and parents worked very, very hard to get that funded by Lowe's. I'm now at Feltonville School of Arts and Science on the other side of North Philadelphia. It's around B in Wyoming. And I teach kids from Puerto Rico, the Dominican Republic, and the Middle East. And I work all year to build up their trust and try to help them and do whatever it is to get them from one point to another. I know they're learning, they know they're learning. When the time for the test comes, they can't look me in the eye anymore because I made them do something they cannot do. If you told your 8-year-old to go drive the car to the supermarket and they crashed, is it their fault or your fault?
Your fault.
So they don't understand the government is making me do this to you. They know that they have to sit in front of these tests. So at my school, we decided to inform parents and kids that they didn't have to take this test. 40% of the kids at our school opted out. It was not widely covered. It was not appreciated by the School District of Philadelphia. These children were not going to score in a way that it was going to move them forward in any way, shape, or form. A lot of them just stayed home in the morning and hung out and helped their mom clean their house and did something a lot more productive than feeling bad about themselves and failing a test that was designed for them to fail. I urge you to not make your child take this test.
Yes.
The minute kids, I've been teaching in the city for 20 years, the minute black and brown children started doing better on these tests, they made it different and harder so that they couldn't do well.
Yes.
It's a fact. And if you look at the data, as soon as the test scores start to rise, oh no, we need a new system. We need the Common Core. We need a new test. We need to spend $158 million fixing it. Employees at the School District of Philadelphia are paid approximately $1 million, about 10 administrators in the Department of Assessment at the School District of Philadelphia. There's $1 million worth of people that want your kid to take this test. But you know in your heart, if your kid got below basic in second grade and third grade and fourth grade, and we have to stop torturing our children. I need kids to look me in the eye in May and June and not completely break the trust with children. And the only way we're going to do that, parents, is together. Teachers feel very, very afraid. It's a very, very taboo subject. I'm stupid for even doing the whole opt-out thing, and I can't believe I'm not fired. But you need to give the teachers, you need to bond with them again. Our relationships with parents have been broken by the system, not between us. There has been so many systematic ways in which teachers and parents, that's a whole nother research study, on how they have broken our relationship. We need to try again to bond for the sake of kids. And this is the main thing that we really, really need to fight against.
I want to ask Ms. Roof to come up now. She's at Frederick Douglass, which was turned into Young Scholars, which was now turned into Mastery Charter School. There's like lawsuits and everything because it was turned into a Mastery Charter School without any public input. And that's what they're doing with our public education right now. They're doing whatever they want to do. And we need to stand up. And
thank you. If I teach anybody anything, it is about organizing. It is about standing for yourself. My son attended Douglass School many years ago, and he came home from school one day and said, "Mom, there's something wrong. Those kids are standing on the desk." And so the teaching that I do is at the neighborhood level. As a founder of a community development corporation that has built homes in the community, it's important to me that 152 townhouses, actually, we were community partners on building the homes at 21st and Nars, the last phase of Raymond Rosen Homes. And any realtor would tell you that your property is important and the property value is important in large respect, because the schools need to be successful in the area in order for people to even want to buy. You want to be located near a thriving school, near a good hospital, near decent playgrounds, near decent libraries. You want resources for your loved ones that are going to live in your home. And so I have such regard for what Sister Dorsey is doing and for all the troops that are gathered here, because it is yet again a fight. And I've been fighting in Philly for 40 years, and we're still fighting, but we're kicking it up another notch. And you know why? Because our children are involved. And why? Many respects, I'm old school. I put feet on the street and knock on doors and organize and work political campaigns and things like that. And you're right. The vote does matter. And we need to hand a whole lot of folk the one ass. It's about that time. And just say, time's up. And make sure that our young people understand to register to vote and take their vote. Walk it and the power that we as parents and as elders and as community people, as teachers, have given them. I was one of the founding students of Strawberry Mansion High School. My little poem or whatever I wrote is in the cornerstone of that school back in 1964. And it was a big deal. We put together a time capsule. And we said that whenever that school is torn down, they will get to see what was happening in 1964. What was happening in our community in 1964. The Philadelphia School District has a budget of close to or over $3 billion. What do we get for it? If the School District of Philadelphia was traded on Wall Street, what would be the stock value based on its performance? Do the math. Look around your communities, and what do we have? We don't have a lot. The joke that was played on our community at Frederick Douglass Elementary School was that young scholars who got the contract to do the turnaround of Frederick Douglass School as a part of the Renaissance Initiative that the Obama administration set forth 5 years ago, that the school district got together and chased the money for. And the criteria, let's remind you, the criteria was that the school had to be failing for 10 years or more. For Frederick Douglass School, had a principal, James Kane, who was the principal for over 25 years. Right there at 22nd and Norris Street. He was my fourth grade teacher from Carver, which is now Engineering and Science. Again, George Washington Carver Elementary School. So again, you're talking about giants. African American giants. George Washington Carver, an inventor. Frederick Douglass, a fighter, who said, "No power concedes to nothing without a demand." And that is very much what this is about, what the teaching of the opt-out is about, getting ahead of the curve here in terms of looking at what's up with the Keystone test, getting ahead of the curve in terms of organizing. It is very, very, very critical. It's no accident that after James Kane retired from Frederick Douglass School, that over a span of 10 years, their qualifying 10 years for the Renaissance program, there were seven principals. And so, we're under attack from a whole lot of different angles, okay? For young scholars to say, oh, well, we did good for the first two years. Well, you came from nothing. The school, the qualifying factor was that the school had to be a failing school for 10 consecutive years. Hello? But for the CEO of Young Scholars to stand before presidents, to send out robocalls, and hold a Monday morning meeting and said, oh, the school district's picking on us, we got a call at 5 o'clock and on Friday and they're not gonna renew our contract, we need you to come forward and support us and help us, and to have parents kick into the mode of calling legislators, calling their council people, writing letters and say, don't close our school, we love young scholars, they have helped our children, they helped turn our school around. What that man did was lie to those parents. He should have shown them his report card, the report card for Young Scholars, because it would have shown the failing scores, and that's why the contract was not renewed. But the school district had a process for selection of the Renaissance School, which meant that the first year the parents and the school advisory council, which included community people such as myself. I was the de facto chair. And Ms. Wiggins was a part of the council as well. What they did was, give us an opportunity to say at the 1 year interval, this is not working. And then the next interval is the fifth year. What happened, because the school district did not have a process for what if the Renaissance school does not, the charter provider for the Renaissance school fails. The school district did not think through that part of it. So it had nothing but non-renewal. What the CEO of Young Scholars did was reach out to Scott Gordon, the CEO of Mastery Charter Schools, and they made a deal that instead of Young Scholars experiencing the same embarrassment in the media as Universal Beaufort did, and also Delaware Valley, the non-renewal, they came up with a deal that the charter office signed on to, which said that Mastery would simply, as of July 1, take over the charter. They even had the school advisory council of four member school advisory council, who were told a half-truth, who till this day has not been given the report card of Young Scholars. Even though Ms. Wiggins and I requested it, still that the school charter office give it to them, they now have that contract. And because we met with the policy director for the State Department of Education, we learned that even she was not told the truth about what happened. And so to be vocal is valuable. Because if we had not been vocal and gone up to Harrisburg and had that meeting with her last week, she would have not heard the truth about what happened here in Philadelphia. And I think the other challenge is a legal challenge, which is why it's important for you to have on that literature the Education Law Project. Because a lot of what's happening to us and the disenfranchisement that's happening at the community level is also happening at the education level as well. And displacement is displacement. Rather, it's by demolishing our homes, or rather it's by denying the vote or manipulating the vote, or rather it's by tactically making moves that would deny you the kind of education that you're entitled to. So I am honored to be here and be a part of this movement. You're educating me about opt out, and I'm on.
All right.
Thank you. I'm opting in to opt out.
That's right.
If we don't want testing for our schools, what is it that we do want in our schools? And that's why I asked Ms. Jackie Wiggins to come up, because she's taught in our schools. She's teaching at CCP right now, and she's a historian. So I just wanted her to shed some light on what we would like to see in our schools.
I talk a lot about race and gender because that's where I am. When Alicia just said I teach community college, I've been there over 20 years, adjunct, sometimes full-time, depending on the schedule. And so that you know, majority of young people or students, period, who come to community college who are African-American find themselves in O-level classes. Any CCP students here? Graduates here? All right, couple. You know, some folks take the placement test. It is an open admission school, but you have to take a placement test to sort of see where you are. And these O-level classes, these are just extra credits on your transcript. Nothing towards your graduation requirements and so forth. It is criminal. It's as simple as that. I don't know how else to put it. So we're talking about opting in, and I'm sorry, there was a phrase that you used that I'm trying to remember, but I'm retired from the school district, so my brain is a little different right now. But the thing that I want to talk about is something that happened at Frederick Douglass, and that was on the night that there was a meeting where really Mastery, under its leader, Scott Gordon, I don't know his background, but we did find that the background of the previous EMO, Lars Beck of Young Scholars, was that of a senior vice president for a beer company. Yeah, he said it himself. So all I know is that Scott Gordon's background is in finance and so forth. But a parent asked the question, if in effect the teachers under Young Scholars did not do the job in terms of being effective, do you plan to hire them? And he said he was going to hire some of them. So I asked the question, well, can you tell me or give me a breakdown of your teachers by race and gender? And his response was, one third of the teaching force, he may have said, I don't think he said teachers of color, I think he said African American, and two thirds are Caucasian. So my next question was, what would be on the transcripts of these teachers that would let a school, let parents, let all the stakeholders know that these teachers have knowledge of the African American experience, the family experiences, and so forth? He said without skipping a beat. Well, I doubt very seriously if anything like that would be on their transcripts. Now let me just ratchet this up to the meeting last week with Beth Orloff, the policy director for the School of Education, for the Department of Education. When I brought up the same type of thing, it's almost as if, yeah, these schools of education aren't really doing their job. Then why do they get money? They're not going to do the job. You see, a part of the educational process is that young people begin to learn how to connect the dots, as you have said, and to make sense of these things that are happening, okay? And some folks are making sense, some folks are not making sense. So when we're looking at, when I looked at how happy some of the parents were that, in effect, Mastery Charter was going to take over their school, I couldn't quite believe it, but that's only because folks aren't informed.
Right, right.
They're not doing the homework.
Right.
So let me just point out a little bit of the homework. Mastery gets all this play, right? Oprah, blah, 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 blah. So when Ruth demanded a meeting with the charter office, Ruth's a bad...
Yes, she is. Badass teacher right there.
All right, right there, okay.
Yes, she is.
I said, I looked at the scores and I said, okay, let me just ask you this. If Mastery gets all this play, what do you think would be maybe an average score for math? What do you think? Just yell out what you think. What do you think?
70.
70. What do you think?
80.
80? Anybody? 75? Okay. Let me read to you the scores of the cohort that was up for renewal for Mastery. Mastery Harity. I'm going to go 2010 because I think the first year was the district. 2010, 2011, 54.1. 2011, 2012, 64.4. 2012 to 2013, 55.58. 2013, 2014, 54.63. Now, Mastery Man. Mastery Man, okay? I'm going to read you 2010, 2011, 61.7. 2011, 2012, things, this is what happened, 83.7. 2012, 2013, 79.24. 2013, 2014, 75.93. But, give me a sense of what you think the reading scores would be. 85. Okay, now let me go to the same school that got these last 3 years of high grades or high scores for math. Mastery Man, 2010, 2011, 46.1. 2011, 2012, 61.4. 2012, 2013, 55.21. 2013, 2014, 52.88. I didn't have enough, I was running off something else, and I couldn't find the sheet. But this is available to everyone on computer. All right, it's a sham, it's a scam. We just gotta get, you know, it's a lie. When you look at some of the other scores, I mean, they aren't either, I don't see, the only thing that had a 75 was really that year in math. Everything else in a lot of the other schools, and this was Young Scholars, was, can you believe it? Young Scholars in 2011, 2012, 17.6. And then it went to a minus 7. What are people doing? Why are folks getting paychecks?
Yeah.
See, that's the deal. So, with respect to that, there is a piece that I sort of pulled up. Can you hear me without the mic?
No.
Oh, okay. It's talking about culturally relevant teaching. And so there is this one little piece I thought was very interesting when I saw it. Ruth said, you didn't say that at the meeting. I just couldn't find it, but I'm going to read it now. It says, teaching should be informed not only by the content of the discipline, but also by the lives of the students. Which means that teachers coming in should have knowledge of their audience. They should have knowledge of who it is they're teaching. And you cannot get that in a 5-week little program, 1 hour a day. You cannot do that. You gotta spend that ducats like I had to. I think, Jesse, you mentioned your daughter's first black teacher was when?
In college.
In college. My first black teacher was kindergarten. My second was third grade. None for all of high school at our local Catholic Girls High School. None for 4 years at Penn State University. My graduate work was a little different. I was shocked, to tell you the truth. But is this the norm? Is this the way it should be when America's going to be 51-52% people of color? So with respect to everything that I'm talking about, culturally relevant teaching is something that we need to use, and we need to ask these questions of. Who's teaching our children by race and gender? How are they coming prepared to teach our... These are fair questions in 2015. And as Jesse said, if the whole deal is that you're going to be dumbed down, how are you going to pass any of the tests that are being required? Because some states, I think you mentioned your state, there are 4 tests that a teacher would have to take in order to get certification. We know about the praxis here.
Our speaker's done a great job of pointing out the reason why neighborhood networks exist, which is to overcome the power of big money on all our institutions and also on our electoral system. You know, the impact of big money is within all our institutions, and one of the main institutions which is keeping us down is the system which provides us with the politicians who make the rules. And I'm not going to go into a lot of detail. You all know about Citizens United and all of the stuff about how the Federal Election Commission really, for all intents and purposes, doesn't even exist anymore. It's the wild, wild west where what the billionaires want basically rules. So we don't accept that, and we recognize that the only way to overcome that is through grassroots power, grassroots power that has a smart idea about how to organize itself. So we totally agree we need to get rid of the politicians who are effectuating these policies, and the way to do that is really to reverse engineer the way the Democratic Party puts them in office. The way the Democratic Party puts them in office is to organize by neighborhoods. They call the neighborhoods divisions. Divisions are in wards. And those of you who are, I know all of you here are sophisticated veterans of the political wars, you know that they have 2 committee people per division. Those are their warriors. They then come together, elect ward leaders who basically are princes of the party. And those princes of the party then really tell those committee people what to do come each election. So we have to have our own committee people, but, you know, not only by electing them every 4 years. You know, they used to elect them every 2 years, but that gave us too much of a chance to actually change the faces. So now it's only 4 years, and they figure that we will just give up. Well, we don't have to give up. Neighborhood Networks has not given up, and what we do is we ask people to be coordinators politically without the title. So you don't need the title to be a captain in your division and spread information in your division that when you go to this polling place, you're going to see me there at that polling place. And I'm going to have information about the ones who are controlled by money and the ones who aren't controlled by money. And if we have enough people like that throughout the city, then we don't have to accept this money-driven oligarchy that is running our party, our city, our state, and our country. The pay-to-play system can only be overcome if we play for principle and if we do it smartly. So we can get rid of the politicians who have basically sold themselves and get a set that represent us. And if we do this well enough, some of them can be us. We don't have to just accept the choices that they give us. Some of those choices can be us if we organize well enough. And that's what we do. So we have sign-up sheets over there. Hope everybody will sign up. You'll hear from us. And The next thing we're probably going to do is get involved in trying to elect a teacher who's running as a Green Party member to displace one of the Republicans who's now on city council. Not going to be that easy, but we have to try to do it, and if enough people are committed to doing it, we can do it. So please sign up. Thank you.
National campaign to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. The campaign started in Seattle, where they passed $15 minimum wage. So we're organizing in Philly, and we know that, you know, education and poverty are directly related. A lot of people, most of these like schools that are failing, you know, most of the parents are working low-wage jobs and can't commit time or energy even to like paying attention to their kids' education, as someone said, because it's like you're too worried about paying the rent or keeping the lights on or, you know, taking care of food. So obviously we want people to have control over like these important parts of their lives, like including education. So we're organizing in Philly. We're always looking for people who want to get involved, and we would like love to work with any other groups who care about raising the minimum wage and ending poverty in Philadelphia.
So I'm already tall, but I like being taller. In my mind, I always felt as a kid, if I could be like 7 feet tall, I'd be invincible. I don't believe that anymore, but I did when I was a kid. So I'm happy to be here. Carly's amazing. That's wonderful to follow up. A lot of the work Carly does, I'm involved in general across the city. A lot of work with families experiencing homelessness. A lot of work with youth who have been adjudicated, foster care, been homeless. They've just went through the ringer. And a lot of them are also parents themselves. And I think that's a large, large part of the conversation that often when we're talking about systems, people forget. So I work for a wonderful space and place called the Village of Arts and Humanities. We're about 40 plus years old. We used to be known as the Ile Ife Black Humanitarian Center. We actually, we have a dope plaque outside now that they just finished all this construction over in the Germantown Lehigh area. So it was a really great plaque with a statement about who we are. In the late 80s, we became known as the Village of Arts and Humanities. And we really have a mantra of community development and economic development through the arts. Everything we do is through the lens of the arts. I'm a program manager there. I deal with all the youth arts education stuff. So it's an after-school program. It's year-round. We have a summer program that's in high gear right now, and partly why my voice is gone. About 90 folks between the ages of 9 and 19 running through that building and through a couple of our buildings. We started off with this one row home and now have expanded. We own about 10 to 12 row homes in that neighborhood. We actually cater and own a bunch of land that we call art parks that have a ton of mosaics. And the murals up there are all us too. And they're spread all over throughout that little northern corner in the Fair Hill area. We employ a ton of folks that deal with reentry issues. We actually have specific programming for that population because we believe that a healthy community is also a working community. And we believe in the equitable access to jobs and for people to provide for themselves as a way of restoration that's beyond just help as usual. That's not our mantra. So we also manage the commercial corridor for the city over there, which is another way we're able to employ so many folks dealing with reentry issues. I mean, we have a lot of stuff happening at the Village. We have an international artist in residency program that we just got a big old grant for. Thank you, Pew, that allows us to take young people in Philly and put them around artists from all across the world, and we're really excited about it. The best part about the Village, everything we do costs $0 to our participants. We are the only arts program in the city that can actually say that. With the tiki head on, it's worth clapping for. I'm blessed to actually supervise a teaching artist staff that is through the roof. And I've worked about 12 years in the city at a variety of arts institutions, and I've never seen a roster like this that teaches children for free, 9 to 19. We have a paid internship program for teenagers, so we're often also a teenager's first job. We teach them how to deal with some of the businesses in the commercial corridor at the same time that we teach them about entrepreneurship through the arts and give them a whole lot of good experience at work. So please check us out, the Village of Arts and Humanities. We're at 2544 Germantown Avenue, right like two blocks south of the Germantown Lehigh intersection. If anybody's been in the Germantown Lehigh area, all that painting, that's actually us. We did that.
Nice.
So yeah. That's us being the wonderful people we are, and we love communities, and we want you guys to come out and just see us, learn about us, tell your friends, all that jazz. We're working on a lot of new partnerships. My other role in world, yeah, I'll be really quick, is dealing with something called trauma. Carly talked about it beautifully, so I don't really need to recap that. But a lot of my world is spent looking at larger systems and then looking at, on the ground, how people are dealing with these traumas and trying to figure out what are the clever ways of partnership. What are the clever ways of innovative, problem solving and solutions-based, oriented thinking that we can put on these subjects and put on these problems? And so there's a wonderful group of people that I get to work with, including Carly and Miss Sherry, and a series of residents in Strawberry Mansion. And ironically, through some funding from the most unlikely funder in the world, I think, the Department of Justice, we are looking at ways to address community-level traumas that does not include sending people to jail, increased policing, and doesn't include ripping apart families.
Yes.
So yes. So
yes.
It is. It's quite the project. We are about 9 months in, and really they have. I have the blessing of working in Strawberry Mansion. I don't live in Mansion, but I have the blessing of working there and really working around the energy of people that love their community. This ugly narrative about Strawberry Mansion and nobody caring about Mansion from inside Mansion is just a lie. And so stuff like this is important, stuff like what Carly is talking about or the work we're doing around trauma. So please look it up, something called Trauma Theory. Check out something called the ACEs Study, the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study. It is revolutionary work and will change our world pretty soon. And also, please check out all the research about arts and community resilience. It'll also be changing the world. Hopefully, Strawberry Mansion very soon. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate coming out. And have a great night.
Thank you.
But can we give a big shout out to Black Captain Rodney Bush? He also cooked the food and helped get this all situated also.
I'm finding so many different mentalities. It seems challenging. I don't say hard, because only thing hard is we can't create that we walk on. Everything else is a challenge. So I'm ready for this challenge. And I was built for this. I think that we all have a purpose in life. And most of the people say it's impossible. Mentalities, there are different mentalities, but just like there's different ways to teach people how to read, there's different ways to communicate people, and there's different mentalities. So I do see hope, and that's all coming together and understanding each other and learning.